college students, log on to your Cardinal app. Hit the link and tune in to ycradio.org. My name is Lisa Ray, and you're listening to ycradio.org, the voice of today's generation.
Welcome you to all of our listeners and to our viewers. My name is Dr. Jonathan Quash with the York College Division of Enrollment Management Student Affairs. We have an amazing show for you today. It is going to be a fantastic opportunity for us to discuss the new Social Justice Institute that is here at York College, which is being led by and headed by Professor Ebony Jackson. But on today's program, we are so excited to have an amazing array of talent, amazing array of individuals who are going to discuss hip hop and social justice. And so leading off the show and sort of getting us on our way is Mr. Jeremiah Duffy. He's a student,
a journalism major
and working as a one of our associates in the YC Radio. And so thank you, Jeremiah. Take it away.
Hey, thank you for the intro. Welcome to the show, students, faculty of life, and I wanted to start out as a newbie to the game with some shout outs to our new president, Dr. Paranicia Johnson-Eanes. Congratulations to her. To YC Radio, our new show, YC on Purpose, the Black Lives Matter movement, Mom, Obama, Dr. White, our co-host. Dr. Andrews, who put me on, and Ebony Jackson and Jonathan Quash, who put the players together. Thank you so much. And Brian on the tech. I'll tell you a little bit about myself and what brought me here. I grew up in New York. I'm from Queens and lived in the Bronx, New York native. And I've been very privileged to go to private schools and had to sneak my way into listening to hip hop on the radio and putting lyrics together where I could, as some strict parents, you know, aren't into the hippity hop as we hear. But throughout my experience, my young experience here in the US, we've come across differences in our citizenship and status and how that relates to not just opportunity, but our rights and our freedoms and liberties, if you will. And A couple of places I've lived across the East Coast, I ran into some, let's call it history, but profiling with the police living down south in Tennessee, and also up here in New York and in the Caribbean when I lived there. But presently, I am a journalism student. I thought that was the best way to share this information, reach not only, you know, the professors and represent ourselves well and our people, but to, I guess, disseminate and filter that misinformation to my fellow peers and other students of life and those wishing to seek truth. So I'm very grateful for the opportunity. I hope we all enjoy the show. I've noticed a lot of changes as far as music goes, but in hip hop in particular, so much has changed and yet so much has stayed the same. We have still East Coast and West Coast beefs. We still have the struggle. We still have selling drugs and gang banging. But the, as Dr. White, you know, summed it up so well, the fight for upward mobility through it all. And that comes in betterment of self, betterment of your mind and opportunities, and the music itself and welcoming the digital age. So I wanted to talk about what's maintained and, you know, what hip hop's kind of meant to me. So one of the songs that came out that I thought spoke to very well the struggle and the movement as far as Black Lives Matter and the protests ongoing was Lil Baby's song of, you know, the bigger picture. And what an apt name to perspective is what I thought it really captured.
Trade my 4x53, ain't no more. I gave him chance, a chance, a chance again. I even told him please. I find it crazy the police to shoot you and know that you dead, but still tell you to freeze. Love, I seen what I seen. I guess that mean hold him down if he say he can't breathe. It's too many mothers just grieving. They killing us for no reason. Been going on for too long to get even. Throw us in cages like dogs and hyenas. I went to court and they sent me to prison. My mama was crushed when they said I can't leave. First I was drunk, then I sobered up quick when I heard all that time that they gave to Talib. He got a life sentence plus. We just some products of our environment. How the fuck they gon' blame us? You can't fight fire with fire, I know, but at least we can turn up the flames some. Every color person ain't dumb, and all whites not racist. I be judging by the mind and heart, I ain't really in the faces. Though the way that we living is not getting better, you gotta know how to survive. Crazy, I had to tell all of my loved ones to carry a gun when they going outside. Stay in the mirror whenever you drive. Overprotect to go crazy for mine. You gotta pay attention to the sign. Seem like the blind following the blind. Thinking about everything that's going on. I boost security up in my home. I'm with my kind and they right or they wrong. I call him now, he'll pick up the phone. And it's 5 a.m, he waking up on it. Tell him wherever I'm at, then they coming. I see blue lights, I get scared and start running. That should be crazy, they supposed to protect us. Swords and handcuffs and arrest us. Why they go home at night, that shit messed up. Knowing we need to help, they neglect us. One of them who gon' make them respect us. I can see in your eye that you fed up. Go around, got my shot, I won't let up. They know that we a problem together. They know that we can storm anywhere. It's bigger than black and white. It's a problem with the whole way of life. It can't change overnight. But we gotta start somewhere. Might as well go ahead, start here. We done had a hell of a year. I'ma make it count why I'm here. God is the only man I fear. Kid, I'm going on the front line. He gon' bust your work if you come at that gun line. You know when the storm go away, then the sunshine. Gotta put your head in the game when it's crunch time. I want all my sons to grow up to be monsters. I want all my daughters to show out in public. Seem like we losing our country, but we gotta stand up for something. So this what it comes to. Every video I see on my conscience, I got power now, I gotta say something. Corrupt the police been the problem where I'm from. But I'd be lying if I said it was all of them. I ain't do this for the trend, I don't follow them. Altercation with the law, had a lot of them. People speaking for the people, I'm proud of them. Stick together, we can get it up out of them. I can't lie like I don't rap about killing and dope, but I'm telling my young is to vote. I deal what I did cause I didn't have no choice and no hope. I was forced to just jump in and go. This bullshit is all that we know, but it's time for a change. Got time to be serious, no time for no games. Ain't taking no more, let us go for them chains. God bless they soul, every one of them names. It's bigger than black and white. It's a problem with the whole way of life. It can't change overnight, but we gotta start somewhere. Might as well go ahead, start here. We done had a hell of a year. I'ma make it count why I'm here. God is the only man I fear. They training officers, the killers, then shooting protesters with these rubber bullets. They regular people, I know that they feel it. These scars are deep.
All right, well, we'll let you listen to the rest of the song on your own time. But I thought it was I literally got goosebumps the first time I heard it. If you get a chance to watch the video, it has clips of him It's true. It's people in the midst of the protest, literally, in the streets. And I thought it was just such a drastic change from what I'm used to hearing from this artist. Knew very little about him, as the trap movement, a lot of people will tell you, is still up and coming. Still a lot of artists, a lot of competition, a lot of people hungry. But the only other song I knew from Baby was Pure Cocaine. And not going to promote. I'm just going to say that going from that message, that level of, you know, the mo money, mo problems, the 99 problems, the don't push me, you know, this is all I got, product of my environment, as he said, to, you know, wanting to speak on that freedom of speech, of using his platform, I thought was an incredible leap for this artist in particular. But it was a great statement to what a lot of artists go through. And it formed some questions for me, you know, as far as what you do with your money, what you do with your platform and your voice, your talent. And as far as security for law enforcement, when, in quote, they're supposed to protect us, and they throw us in handcuffs and arrest us. As far as our country and what you stand up for, I thought a lot of these things were just timeless. And what really brought about, you know, this awakening, if you will, for so many of the young artists. And wanted to pose that question to my sensei, Dr. White, or any other members. But what did you think about the song? I know you felt somewhat.
Oh yeah, no, it's an amazing song. And let me first start by welcoming you to York College, Jeremiah. It's great that you're here. We're very, very excited that you're here. So thank you. You know, I guess let me just say that. As somebody who's a longtime fan and teacher of hip hop, I try to examine hip hop as art. I try to take it seriously as art. But what these folks are creating is artistic in many ways, and it's layered. And so I don't have the background because I had not heard of this artist previously. But one of the things that I really enjoyed about the song itself was the way that he kind of blended some of the tropes of trap music and gangster rap into the protest. So he didn't, it's easy as an artist to create a picture of yourself where you look heroic and pristine, and that's not what he did. He had the chance, he could have done something like that, and he didn't. And so it was interesting, just like the very first line, he trades in his truck, his 4x4, for an AMG G63. Oh, that's an expensive Mercedes, you know, SUV. But then the video, what vehicle is he on? He's on a bike the whole time. He's on a bike. Yeah. So it's almost as if he's saying, you know, if there's real work to be done, this is what we have to do. We have to be in the streets. It's not about having a truck. And engaging in all this conspicuous consumption, which I would actually argue is an effective trope in gangster rap in terms of talking about the nature of America. But that's a whole nother thing I'm gonna put to the side. And I'm going on here and I'm rambling, but I will say one last thing and I'll flip it back to you is, there's a line in there where he talks early in the first verse about how the police will say freeze even after they've shot you and they know you're dead. And just knowing you're dead, and that means just stay on your neck longer. And to me, that's a really, really significant statement, because in listening to either the conservative reactions, and I'm not gonna say any names, but listen to pundits or read people writing about George Floyd, for instance. But you know, the same thing happened with Michael Brown, same thing happened with Eric Gardner, same thing happened with everybody else, is that people are justifying this slaughter. And when I hear conservatives say this, typically in my mind, a political conservative is someone who defends a particular status quo. So you're defending, for instance, our traditions of law enforcement and justice. At first, everyone is presumed innocent until guilty. and that we have a system in which you have judge, jury, and prosecutors that are acting to determine innocence or guilt. And so what these police slaughters do is not conservative. This is fascism. This is fascism. And what he spoke to, I think, was really, really significant. Even if he can't necessarily articulate it in that way, man, I loved this song. It was amazing. And that's just like three stanzas into the first verse. So, you know, there's a lot more to talk about, but you go ahead, you know.
And the bass ain't bad either.
All right.
But I wanted to say, those who don't know, Dr. White has that law background, but we can
quickly interject. I'm sorry, Jeremiah. I wanted to also formally introduce Dr. White too, which I didn't do at the beginning, but he is the chairman of the History and Philosophy Department. Also, he does an amazing course on the history of hip hop. So if any students who are listening out there are interested in that course, definitely, definitely, definitely take it. It is writing intensive, but it's a really, really cool course. but also we have with us, and I'm gonna ask at this point, if Ebony Jackson, who's the director of our Women's Center, she is also the one who is sort of responsible for this program today regarding the Social Justice Institute. But she would introduce her very special guest, Professor Wes Jackson.
All right. Thank you, guys. I'm so excited to be back here again. And I want to thank all of the participants and our hosts, and Dr. Quash for making it work, and Brian and all the people behind YC Radio. So we're excited Dr. Quash and Dr. Andrews and I got together. We had an event a couple of weeks ago when we wanted to follow this up and keep the good conversation going. And we thought about how the music was really kind of a soundtrack for this movement that is has been going on and continues to go on. And one of the first guests that we thought of, actually it wasn't even me that thought of it, I think it was Dr. Quash, was Wes Jackson. And so I walked downstairs and invited him to be on the program. Since full disclosure, I'm, you know, kind of married to him. So I can get the family discount, which is wonderful. But Wes actually is formerly of York College. Wes was at York for several years. I want to say about 5 or 6 years. But currently he is at Emerson College, and he's director of the Business of Creative Enterprises program, which is an entrepreneurship and a business program for the creative industries. So it's completely up his alley. Formerly, while he was at York College, he was also the founding director and managing partner for Brooklyn Bodega, which is the company that produces the Brooklyn Hip Hop Festival. He has many other titles, but I will leave it there and let the conversation go on.
So thank you to that. And you see, Dr. White, you see how she does me, right?
What's up, dude? What's up?
kind of married, kind of. I don't know. Are we entangled? Is that what you're trying to imply, Evan? But thank you to everybody. But thanks to Dr. Quash and Dr. White and Dr. Tom. I see. It's good to see. I haven't seen you in a long time. And also everybody, the crew at YC Radio when I was an adjunct at York College. Did my show there, so I love everybody at YC Radio, and I am happy to help, obviously, to, you know, the wonderful, brilliant minds here. And I suppose if I said no, I would be in a deeper bit of trouble at home, but I would have said yes anyway to you, Dr. Quash, so don't worry about it. You don't need to lean on her too much. So thanks for having me.
Our pleasure. Can we start off with a few interview questions? And for those who don't know about your history in the audience, he helped found the Brooklyn Hip Hop Festival, as well as start the Seven Heads Promotions Group. We'll start with what kind of brought you to York and music, and let you go from there.
Okay. I'll try to keep it brief, but yeah, so I have been working in the hip hop cultural space since I really graduated undergrad in 95 now. But I started my very first sort of entrepreneurial streak. So I started Seven Heads Enterprises, which was a promotions company, artist management, and then a boutique record label, then turned into a marketing company, then turned to Brooklyn Bodega, which produces the Brooklyn Hip Hop Festival. So I have to say, to be honest, in between really the end of the marketing company, which was the room service group, and the maturation of the festival is when I started working at York College, and Ebony was there and she was teaching a class, and then she sort of got moved over to the admin side, and I sort of kind of picked up her pieces there, supposed to be temporarily, but I really enjoyed the beauty of teaching. I enjoyed working with the York students in particular, and very quickly I realized that this was my next calling, was sort of higher ed, that I get the same rush from being in a classroom that I got, you know, putting out a record or going on tour. So I was very grateful. I'm always going to be grateful to York College for that. And again, all the wonderful people here who have helped me here or there with kind words. But I was always, so I say that the festival actually had a downturn. We had a kind of a bad year, and the industry was in a bit of a free for all after the file sharing revolution. And I'm not gonna lie, like, I was short on some money. So I needed to pick up something that could supplement it. And so almost out of that tragedy of the room service group falling apart, led me to higher ed. So I just, to everybody listening, there's always an upside to these crises if you just sort of keep your head about you. So I'm almost grateful to that crash, or else I wouldn't be here. But I grew up, I'm 40, be 47 years old. I grew up in the South Bronx. I was born in October. Kool Herc had the party on Sedgwick in August of 73. So I don't know really anything but hip hop. It was the first record I can remember my brother Rob playing it. So I was always around in it. But my particular journey is I tried to be a practitioner, all right? I tried to rhyme, tried to DJ, beatbox, and do graffiti and all of that, and breakdance in the span of about 10 days, failed at it all. And I realized for many years, like, well, what am I going to do? Because I love this art. And it was only when I went to college and I was an English major, so I used to like to write. I thought it was going to be journalism. Then I thought it was going to be filmmaking. And then I realized that my talents, as an entrepreneur, as a businessman, as a person behind the scenes, was where I could contribute to hip hop. So I like to contribute as a business person and as a scholar with the same love, you know, as Little Baby or Jay Electronica has as practitioners. So now I'm just trying to, you know, really inspired by Dr. White, trying to put these two passions together and a final career teaching hip hop would be the perfect sort of end of how it goes. And I just also want to shout out Brian from YC Radio, who's, I slipped in the first part. Brian's my man, 100 grand. I miss him. but I was always here. So I'm just always this hip hop nerd trying to figure out how I can make this all work.
And thank you for your service, sir. Each one teach one. And I really wanted to stay on that theme of education. So looked up, did a little online stalking myself, and saw that you're Emerson's Director of Business of Creative Enterprise Program. So as a Black man, an educator, as a fellow student and love of, with a real passion for music, I have to ask, dealing with COVID, the pandemic, going to the digital do-it-yourself age of music, how has that shifted? And what are you teaching your students now as a facilitator, if you will, in the classroom? One of the themes that came up is, unlike competitors, you were personal. So now having to do the online education, how has that transition worked for you, and what kind of tools are you giving those students in the classroom?
Yeah, so the transition to remote is poses problems, as anyone could imagine, of having your office in the office is the dining room. The dining room is the daycare. The daycare is the junior high school. It's a bit maddening on that level. But in a sense, this is the world that I was raised in, right? The idea of patchworking, you know, albums together, you know, 25 years ago with a producer in London, an MC in Maryland, and the, you know, the mastering engineer in Midtown. I'm already kind of used to assembling like a jigsaw puzzle creatively. So what I've been telling students is, one, yes, it's difficult to, you know, sort of, as we say, grind your beer and then let's get back to work, because there's really no way around it. This could happen on a good day, right? If you are, you know, hip hop fans, I know, you know, Kanye has his issues, but when I remember, I think it was the Dark Twisted Fantasy when he recorded everything in Hawaii, right? The idea was Hawaii, Chicago to LA, New York. Def Jam was in New York. You know, he was living in LA. His mother, you know, he was at family in Chicago. So the idea of that level of geographic collaboration usually winds up being pretty good in my world. But what I'm saying to my students, the second part of your question is, you know, move forward. There's no point in looking back. And when you get caught looking back in business is when you're going to get walloped. Because Tower Records, which I'm sure most people on this call remember, I just did a lecture last night with my students at Emerson. You know, they're gone, right? It's just poof. Now they've sort of popped up as some odd e-commerce thing, probably trying to liquidate their inventory. But Tower Records, when the digital file sharing revolution was destroying it, should have just said, listen, this time is over. I love you, 4th and Broadway. A lot of good memories. Let's cut our losses and let's look to the future. And then they could have gone to Sweden and talked to Daniel Ek and say, what's this Spotify thing you're developing? I want in. Here is $1 million because I liquidated. But instead, they holding on to these leases. They're holding on to the business of plastic. And you just go down with the ship. You have to say, listen, I've been through this turmoil before. And you can't get caught in your feelings, in your sentiments. You have to be, as professionals and scholars, look forward, because there's a new business model emerging. And to young people like you, Jeremiah, and the rest of my students, I say, don't look at us and learn the lessons, but keep moving forward. Get to the next evolution, because yes, it's terrible that Tower Records is gone, but I know it's better for artists in terms of the dissemination of the culture. Spotify is better. You're reaching more people. You know, honestly, you got people who have limited resources, couldn't buy a $20 CD. Now they can get a free, you know, Spotify account or you Pandora account, and they can actually consume, you know, they can consume more music and open their mind. It's a better, it's, some things are gone, but I think the sum total is that it's better. So I just tell people, move forward. You know, when the world, my old world was collapsing, Steve Jobs didn't say, hey, let's assume the leases on Tower Records and open up iTunes, you know, retail. It was to hell with leases, get rid of it. 99 cents, let's break up. Let's look at everything that they did wrong and let's fix it. And everything that killed them, we're not gonna pick up those debts. So you're trapped into albums, I'm doing piece by piece. You're doing $20, I'm doing 99 cents. You got huge leases on 4th and Broadway, I got digital infrastructure. I'm moving on, because people still want music. They just don't want to buy plastic from you. You can't, it's very dangerous not to conflate the two energies.
Excellent. Excellent answer and insight. Thank you. I wanted to kind of stay focused, and Dr. White, you know, feel free to let me know if we're doing it right. But there's the music and then there's the movement. And to keep the two in sync, I wanted to ask if, what do you see as the role of music, specifically hip hop today? And do you think that they're meeting that mark? And I guess to help you, you know, in that, what are the limitations on those artists? So as someone who's had a background and executive experience and dealt with record labels, a lot of artists don't know that there are branding and certain things that they can and cannot say. So can you speak to some of the reasons for that, or, you know, whether you think that's evolving, if you will?
Was that for that was for Dr. White or for me? Oh, that was for me. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I thought you had tossed it to the good doctor.
No, that's for you. But I figured if I was missing anything in the completion of the question, Dr. White could always help
me. Yeah, so I'm sorry. So I was just on the chat actually trying to shout out Dr. White in the meeting. So just run that question by me real quick. Sorry.
No problem. So the role of hip hop and music today, do you think we're meeting that mark and using your executive record label and especially marketing experience? What are the limitations for those artists who are either signed or trying to get signed? And do you think that's something that's going to change, that's already evolved? What are your thoughts on that?
Right. So is hip hop sort of hitting the mark in sort of a social justice framework? I think, well, one, the Lil Baby song you played, I think gives me great hope. You know, my son, our son Miles played that for me while, you know, we were in the park one day. And I think, you know, that is the best liberation song out right now. You know, it's better than people have been taking hits like, you know, Where's Kendrick? And, you know, Cole makes that bizarre song attacking No Name. You know, some of the conscious dudes, it's like, yeah, man, one's got a red hat on. Like, I don't know what y'all doing. You know, and here goes Little Baby who's out there on the front lines. Like, I'm going to tell you, I know what police brutality is. So I think, right, you could slice it any way you want, right? Some people are missing the mark. Some are not. I think you still have people like a Common and a Quali, you know, who are continually clapping on people, continually marching. I would even go one further. I think we're fine, right? I always have a bit of an optimistic view. But the one thing you'll learn about me, and I would love to sort of see what the other fellow scholars here, is that I also don't put hip-hop artists just as the rappers, right, or the producers or the DJs. I consider really these athletes hip-hop artists, right? I've long said that Allen Iverson, when you look at him play basketball, I imagine that's how Jay-Z would play ball if that was where it went. And if Iverson was a MC, I would imagine he would spit like a Jadakiss or something. So I see, just because you don't just have to be a rapper. I could, you know, there's a little bit of artistic integrity in what I do when I compose an email, right? When I craft a contract, I'm writing a rhyme to the way that Quali writes a rhyme. So when you open that up and then you see the athletes like Giannis and Malcolm Brogdon, you know, for my UVA alumni, out there marching in the streets. You got Kaepernick, you know, obviously going to go down as one of our civil rights hero. So it's really hip hop leading everything, right? The rappers, you could slice them a little bit, but it's our energy, right? It's our energy of social commentary and resistance and the spirit of the liberation. This is our movement. And you may not be rapping, you may not realize it, but you're singing our tune. So I think it's really, really great. And to your second point about as an executive, I think it is my obligation to push the economic the economic lever, right? We were talking last night about how much I hated the Washington NFL team for their nickname, right? I don't support the NFL for that reason and the domestic assault and the Kaepernick. I don't give them a dime. But I've long been saying, get rid of that name. It's offensive. But I am a bit of like there's almost a libertarian streak in me. Right, is that the market will dictate. When FedEx says, yeah, you know what? I'm not gonna renew my lease if you still got that offensive name. Then the bigot Snyder is all of a sudden like, oh, I called the meeting. It's amazing what happened. So I think we need to connect the economic power with the cultural power, and we can actually get things done and take control of the hip hop industry, use that lever to break the system, you know, as it were. So I think that's my responsibility, right, is to kind of organize and direct the dollars. But to your last point, I am worried about artists coming up because I know this system. I know this sort of big label system. That's rap music. That's the commercial rap music. They're not really for hip hop culture, right, which is the culture of liberation. So I fear that you may see a muting, a very subtle muting of revolutionary voices, and then a more of a return to a little bit more Trumpian, xenophobic, you know, Second Amendment, really conservatism, to quote Dr. White, and we've seen this before, right? You saw the era of Public Enemy, and then it just goes a little quiet, right? And then they push out, then it's the native tongue goes down, and then it's a little bit more Mace and Puffy. That's a little bit more palatable. That's respectability politics from these Black folk. So I do hope that if we're talking to young artists, keep pushing, keep clapping on them. Do not fall for the banana in the tailpipe of trying to quiet your voice. So keep pushing. And then I think us as old people got to be the battery in their back saying, no, go ahead, I got your back. You know, I got the money, right? I can hire you as an adjunct, something like that, so you can keep doing it, so you're not completely dependent on this untrustworthy system. Hope that answers it, Jeremiah. Okay.
Yeah, just to jump in as well and to just say first, amen to what Weston said. But I think it's also, we have to, as Wes was alluding to, we have to kind of recognize how hip hop has changed as a phenomenon, so that when he was born and when it started, this was completely counterculture. And the cipher for hip hop, the people that created it, and then the people that, checked it and said, yeah, that's cool, or that's not cool, or you should do this, or you should do that. That world was tiny, tiny. And so hip hop makes this slow movement from being counterculture to subculture to now it's mainstream culture. And the ciphers just exploded. And because of it, and there's pros and cons to that. One of the pros is that hip hop is ubiquitous now. I'm older than Wes. I ain't going to say I'm February, but anyway, I remember a time when there was no hip hop. And so I grew up playing an instrument and played music and admired musicians and still do. So one of the things about hip hop becoming mainstream is now, every kid can say, oh, I could do graffiti, or I could dance, or I could MC, or DJ, and maybe it's not all good, but people can try. Whereas it was confined to this little bitty world in the South Bronx and in North, Manhattan. But on the downside, of course, then you have people weighing in with what it should be. And he's absolutely right that we go through this kind of what some people would call the golden age of socially conscious hip hop from, say, 86, 87 to maybe 92. And then boom, the Chronic drops. And you got 84, 85, Run DMC is the hottest thing in the game. And their anthem is, it's like that. And so they're making a commentary about the world, but they're not offering solutions. They're just, it's like that, and that's the way it is. And then here comes Public Enemy, and it's like, yo, we know who's responsible, and this is what we need to do. This is radical. It's crazy. These things do happen in cycles, and sometimes it'll come out in other ways, and it's always there. And so I think part of what Wes is saying is so important that, yeah, you get the Chronic, but then underneath, bubbling underneath, is Tribe Called Quest, same time. And then the group that I'm still in love with, I saw them on cable access TV in 1993, I think, when I was living in Philadelphia, is The Roots. And to me, The Roots do a lot of really incredible socially conscious stuff. But again, it's not, say, as open or as obvious as Public Enemy or KRS-One or even J. Cole or Kendrick Lamar. And sometimes it's all right. I'm, in a way, I'm really glad that it's not falling on J. Cole and Kendrick Lamar and some of these other people to do this really provocative stuff. I think it's great that everybody can kind of share the wealth and talk about their experiences. And one of them that I think is phenomenal before the Black Lives Matter, Breonna Taylor, George Floyd stuff was Cardi B, in terms of just promoting voting and COVID-19 protection. I was like, how much more socially conscious can you be? I mean, I like her art, but it's only about this deep. But that kind of participation, as Wes was saying, is fantastic. And that's on Instagram or on a commercial that she's recording for somebody. So now there's a lot of great stuff to go that's happening that I think can meet the mark. But it's like, every art form. Not everybody's going to be John Coltrane. You know, for every Thelonious Monk, there's going to be an Errol Garner. There's going to be somebody that's not politically engaged, and that's not what they're trying to do. And that's all right. That's life. That's life. So I'll stop there.
No problem. We have our next guest coming on, and we'll let Professor Quash introduce him.
Yeah, thank you, Jeremiah. I want to just introduce our next guest, another voice in this conversation, one of our own here at York. We're very excited to have as part of this program, Dr. Tom Zlabinger, who is the coordinator of the Jazz Studies program here at York College, leader of the York College Jazz Workshop, Big Band, and the Blue Notes. And so we are very excited to have him and join the conversation. So I know, Tom, you've been listening to everything that's been said so far. You may want to jump in or just share a few thoughts. But I do want to just piggyback while I can for a second on what Wes said about hip hop being bigger than just rappers with respect to the movement, and just in terms of culture. I think that's very, very important because as George has pointed out, both and you pointed out, not just in music industry, but there's so many other industries that tangential to hip hop and hip hop culture that are really also impactful in this particular time in U.S. History. I think, Dr. Z, you got to take your mute up.
Thank you for having me, everybody. It's a real honor to be here. Jonathan and Jeremiah and Dr. White and Wes, it's really good to see you. It's been way too long. I am known, or actually I'm trained as an ethnomusicologist. And what does that mean? I study musicians in their environments, and I'm very interested in culture and history. And I'm very glad to be involved in this conversation around music in many, many forms. And I've been thinking a lot about what can I share as someone who has a PhD in ethnomusicology and as a band director and as a musician and you know, as a member of the human race. And I can remember seeing hip hop for the first time. I'm born in 1971, just real quick, because Jeremiah opened up with who we are. I have a bicultural background. I was born in the South. I lived in Florida, Georgia, Tennessee, and then because my father's Austrian, I moved to Austria and I speak German fluently. So I have this bicultural background. So I see things from two different perspectives. And I think it's helped me understand music's outside of my culture. And I think that's what has, or outside of my history rather, has drawn me into other music, specifically jazz and also things like funk and the blues and rock and just, you know, and I even played in a Javanese gamelan as an undergrad. I just like good sound. Whoever's making it, I don't care. It pulls you in, right? And that's all you want. And it's just got to work. And so in regard to this discussion around people and music making in 2020, I think the visual is so important of what things look like, how music looks. I mean, I don't think we can remember a time without the visual in music, whether it was first the album cover or then the music video, and now in little bursts on Instagram and Facebook. And what music looks like is profound, and how it feels. And in a little baby video, when it's out in the streets and you see the unity of it all. And the fact I noticed, I don't know when it came out, but on the YouTube, it was June, early June that this was put together. And it takes a long time to make content like that, multiple angle shots, and it looks really professional. It is professional. And so I was just blown away by the production of it all. To get back to, it's not just the singer at the microphone or the rapper or even the DJ. There's a whole army of people, you know, a nation of millions behind a great moment of music. And whether it doesn't matter what space it comes from, whether it's a hip hop space, jazz space, rock space, and all of that. And then as an ethnomusicologist, I work predominantly in jazz, but also lots of other improvised musics like the blues and also psychedelic music. And I see a direct line from what we're doing right now in 2020, all the way back to the first, you know, murmurings of the blues at the turn of the century, this idea of social critique, dealing with suffering, dealing with identity. As an ethnomusicologist, I'm always concerned about who we are and these social constructs of race and age and gender and nationality, and you know, the list goes on. Who are we and what are we doing? And what are we doing to each other? And I think we're in a watershed movement, and I know we all know this, but the fact that we first had COVID and then we had George Floyd, these things, how they slid and they're sliding back and forth. My family's still maintaining quarantine. We go out once a day just to get the kids out. I've got a 3-year-old and a 6-year-old, and I don't want them to climb the walls more than they are already. So we just got to get them out there and run, but we are staying home still. And to see this whole pandemic politicized, and then in spite of the pandemic, we have all that went on in June. And I remember someone said, you know, we're going to remember this year, 2020, like it was 1776 or 1968. You pick 1919, and it's only June. So what are these people doing? And to see it manifest in the music so quickly, I just was so, it gave me hope. I'm so glad that it's happening. And what is music? Music is our, as they say, journalism is the first draft of history. I would say that maybe music is the second draft. You know, our memories live in music. Whatever music you love, I don't care what genre. Just as long as it's strong and it means something to you, and you're chewing on it, you know, it's very valuable to many of us. So to loop it back in our discussion today, how do we create a more socially just space? How do we achieve peace? You know, this respect and equity and all this stuff. And I think the fact that we have this wonderful tool called the internet, where we can, if we use it well, really listen to one another. If we take the time and go beyond the tweets and beyond the flashes of video, if we dig deep into a conversation like we're having right now, we can really get somewhere. So all this stuff is really mashed up. Identity, memory, community, or in times of COVID, the lack thereof. You know, I saw danger with people, you know, getting together in the streets, and we're seeing it now with all the flare-ups, things increasing in 41 states, wherever you sit on the spectrum. You know, this is, dare I say, an extinction level event, to quote Busta, right? That it's just, what is happening, and how do we turn it back around? And it's so great to see some people doing such great things. And I just wish we had something as powerful as MTV, which would get things to a larger audience quickly. To get back to Wes's idea of the digital, that we have Spotify. We don't have the tribal drum, to quote, you know, reference McLuhan, of radio as a bigger thing. That there are, you know, like YC Radio and other stations, there are smaller drums. We don't have a big drum where we can get it out real fast. It's not, it's shared in a different way. Sharing happens differently since Napster, and especially since Spotify. But we are what we eat, right? We are what we listen to. We are what we share. And we are better for it. And I think we can put things into music, questions into music that we couldn't necessarily put in the news, that sort of bubble up. I remember seeing Run DMC via Aerosmith, I have to admit, in the 80s, Walk This Way, what was this on, you know, but then the video when it smashed down the wall between Aerosmith and Run DMC, that's a heavy, heavy, heavy statement, and they're on the stage together. And then we can discuss, you know, the weight of the event, who, you know, who prospered more from that cultural moment. And we can talk about what was shared and what was not shared and what needs to be shared and how it's shared. And I know I keep saying shared, but that's the word for me. I've got these butterflies behind me, right? That my kids made during the quarantine. And it's been the chrysalis has been an image that we've used a lot in the channels I'm listening to. How are we going to emerge after all of this, after the pandemic and after George Floyd? How are we going to step forward after all this? To reference you too, I think we're still stuck in the moment, or stuck in the middle, if you will. And I'm so glad we're having this conversation to push things forward and see ourselves. I agree with Little Baby, this is bigger than black and white. It's huge. And if we really get that in our bigger brain and our bigger hearts, we're going to really push forward. It's confusing times, but it's also very exciting times.
Hey, Jeremiah, if I could, just on Tom's point, because something as he was talking about blues occurred to me. It's in the third verse. It's one of the couplets early in the third verse. Little Baby says, I won't go too deep because I'm scared they'll get me. And it's something about the blues that when blues songs are written, one artist, I can't remember who it was, said, this is a way of writing or saying things that can't be said out loud.
Yes.
So for Little Baby to say that, I mean, it's amazing. So I don't know if it's just something in that red clay down in Georgia or what, but to Tom's point, yeah, no, it's very bluesy. Very bluesy.
Well, the euphemisms of blues are all over the place, and we see it in hip hop too.
And if I could just sort of just jump, I know there's, you guys got a break coming up, but I almost want to push back on something, Jeremiah, you said in the beginning to build upon the sort of the meta point that Dr. Tom says. Is this segmentation of like, oh, there's East Coast, West Coast, this, that, you know, they're, I just, as a business person, those are really categories. Those are sort of market segmentation, not to get too professorial, but that's just a way to kind of talk to the consumer. But the reality is that NWA, you know, E-40, Too Short are just as conscious, just as revolutionary as Public Enemy, Tribe Called Quest and De La Soul, all of that. So I think you really, it's almost like people say gangster rap, and I don't know, you know, maybe Dr. White, when you get into like West Coast rap, like real like West Coast, like hyphy Bay Area stuff, that's not really what you're, you know, that's something else. Like what Dre and the Chronic, you know, that's a little bit more universal than that category.
Not put Paris. In.
Yeah, Paris, that's heavy stuff. So, and I think that when you look at like a Cardi B, what Dr. White was saying before, listen, Cardi B might be the most conscious rapper around because you may not like what she's saying, but she is those dancers, whatever, the exotic dancers, from an economic standpoint, which is a little bit more my thing, they are the purest representation of the free market. Right? Scarcity, manipulation of the customer, make the customer think that they're always right, make them think that they're in control when they actually have zero control. Nobody can teach you like that more than a stripper, right? You go in there and you think like, oh, here we go. But my wife is on the call, so I'm going to say I've heard.
It's okay. I told you that part, Wes. I told you that. You don't know that part.
Dr. White told me once, there's nothing worse than being in a strip club with getting no attention. When those women deem you not to be valuable, you realize who's really in power. So I think sometimes that's when Cardi, the coronavirus, like she was the one who was like, stop playing, right? And when she was talking about Bernie and allocation of taxes, you laugh a little bit, but who knows better than the problem with taxes than an entrepreneur who collects so much money in cash? You know, Cardi B is way more so. Now she has a little bit of, you know, whatever what she talks about, and you can have all of those comments, but you put Cardi B and Quali in a room, and you'll have one of the most profound conversations, probably more than me. And, you know, somebody smarter than me, like Dr. Tom or Dr. White. I think that'll be a better conversation. So anyway, I just want to kind of like hip-hop,
no problem.
These rules are a little bit opaque, right? We got to say we're all on the same page, which is
right. Well said.
Understanding that Dr. Tom was talking about.
Thank you for shedding that light. And with that note, we'll go ahead and take a break. When we come back, this is YC Radio and the Social Justice Institute. And we can fight the power of Public Enemy.
Funky drummer, music hitting your heart, cause I know you got a soul. Hey, listen if you're missing y'all, swinging while I'm singing.
Hey,
giving what you're getting, knowing what I'm knowing, while the black band's sweating in the rhythm I'm rolling. Gotta give us what we want, gotta give us what we need.
Hey,
our freedom of speech is freedom of death. We got to fight the power that be. Fight the power. Fight the power. Fight the power. Fight the power! Fight the power!
how would that be? As the rhythm's designed to bounce with health successful lives, designed to fill your mind now that you realize the prize arrives. We got the force to start to make it tough. From the heart, it's the start of work of art to revolutionize, make a change, something strange. People, people, we all the same, no one not the same, cause we don't know the game. What we need is awareness, we can't get careless. You say, what is this? All beloved, let's get down to business. Mental self-defense or fitness. The rest is show.
Welcome back to the second half of our program. We're so excited again to be joined here. For those who are perhaps just joining us, we know that there are viewers and listeners, I should say, from different places, through YouTube, through Facebook, through NYC Radio, which we want to also make sure that you please, please tune into future programming for NYC Radio, not just this type of programming with the Social Justice Institute, led by Ebony Jackson, but there are also some other great programs coming up led by the amazing Jeremiah Duffy. And I'm going to turn it back to him right now. Jeremiah, take it away, my friend.
Awesome. Awesome. Thank you. And first half was amazing. We tackled a lot of issues or touched on a lot of topics. That said, one of the staples and joys of being my age, I just turned 32, you know, a little younger, a little less seasoned than you gents, but I get to be in the in-between of what's happening in the trap and rap music right now and today, and getting to discover all that old history of hip-hop, their struggle, groups like, you know, NWA and Fight the Power and Public Enemy. And it's just amazing to see the transition of time and how their messages change, the deliveries change, not just in the undertones of the music and what's happened there, but also with speaking to those issues and using that platform to touch on systemic issues like injustice, police brutality, and, you know, unfair treatment and citizenship. So with that preface, we're going to break down this song, and I'll let Dr. White lead us in that.
Thanks, Jeremiah. One of the first things I would say for listeners and viewers is, if you get a chance, watch the long form video of Fight the Power. The long form video is amazing, and a lot like Little Baby's The Bigger Picture, it is a street video. What's different, it's also a march video, but what's different is the banners that people are carrying that represent either the five boroughs of New York or various states or big cities around the country. And so it also has this feel of a political convention. And true to their kind of Pan-Africanist, Black nationalist ideology, part of what Public Enemy wanted to do is include everybody. So if you watch the video, you see everybody there. There are men, there are women, young people, old people. There's disabled people. This is 89, before people were thinking about ableism. They had somebody in a wheelchair in front of the march procession. I mean, it's an amazing, amazing video to watch. The next thing that I would say is revolutionary about them, and again, not even getting to the lyrics yet, is the sampling. The thing that really separated Public Enemy from everybody else was the density of their sampling. And this was at a time, you know, Wes can tell you guys all the ins and outs of this, but there were no legal prohibitions on samples that jocks could use. So most rap groups, MC and a DJ, they might sample one song or mix a song or two together. These cats, they created a wall of noise that was just, I mean, it was amazing. So there's one song I'm writing a scholarly article about now, because I think it's perfect for the pandemic. 911 is a joke. That song has 10 samples. Fight the Power has 21 samples. It's crazy. Wow. So the richness, the texture of the sound is mind-boggling. The stuff they sampled, some of it you can tell, so like the Funky Drummer, James Brown's Funky Drummer, and then a couple other songs by the JBs, you can hear those, obviously. But then there's other stuff that's in there. There's like this song, almost kind of a gospel pop song that has Jesse Jackson speaking on it. That's in there. Bob Marley's I Shot the Sheriff, that's in there. And if you can hear that, then that is itself a reference to abuses of power. And equity and all these things. And then you get to the lyrics, and then it's an amazing kind of statement. That the song, in many ways, to your earlier point, Jeremiah, about hip hop hitting the mark, this is what Chuck and I'm going to say Public Enemy as a collective, because it was not only Chuck and Flav rapping and Terminator X on the Wheels of Steel and S1W, but it was also, you know, Bill Adler, Bill Stepney, all these guys behind them, and the Bomb Squad. And so they, you know, I think it was Keith Sadler, one of the members of the Bomb Squad, who said that what we're trying to do with our sound is put the voice of God in a hurricane. So they're referring to Chuck D. And it's really important, because Chuck D has this really rich baritone voice, which is incredibly unusual in the 80s, because most of the rappers have these very high, you know, almost nasally deliveries, and the flow is great, but they're very nasal. You don't hear baritones again really until comes some of this gangster and trap stuff. You know, so it was incredibly unusual, and they knew it. And so we want to build a sound around these lyrics. So he's talking about, you know, we're here to pump the stuff to make you tough, you know, to fill your mind. Our rhyme, that's our objective.
Yeah.
Our rhymes are to fill your mind that you believe in yourself and you understand the reality of your situation. So in the first verse, there's this great line, our freedom of speech is freedom of death.
Yeah, like, I want to ask what, yeah, they say, give us what we need, give us what we want.
Yeah.
What's the reference to, well, I understand, but as a historian, can you share for the audience what they, the full video, they say, you know, they're playing We Shall Overcome, they're talking about the protest, and then they, you know, hit the DJ, you know, and they're right. Like, you know, this ain't no 1963.
Right, right. So,
what the change is there and what they're talking, yeah, references.
Part of it is, I would say, and I love Chuck D, but I think part of it is kind of the arrogance of youth, so that we all want to, because I went through it when I was a college student, you out there protesting, it was anti-apartheid for me, and you out there protesting, and ain't nobody done it like you. You know, so part of that's that. But also part of it is that these cats were very well read, all right? People may not understand this, but they met at Adelphi University. They were college students, and they're taking classes in Black studies, and then they're taking what they're learning and putting it on wax. So they're connecting what is happening in the politics of abandonment in the 1980s, this conservative backlash that had kind of just really crystallized with Ronald Reagan and the Reagan administration and carried through with George Herbert Walker Bush. They're speaking to that, but then connecting it to these chains of resistance that have been happening in this country forever, so that none of this is really new, but we're going to take it in a different direction. That's kind of how I interpret that. And at the time, you know, I just remember being blown away. Even their first disc that they dropped, Yo Bum Rush the Show, where they're talking about Nelson Mandela, and I'm just like, whoa, who are these guys? Nobody talks about this stuff. So throughout the lyrics, and there are a couple of couplets, I'm gonna see if I can pull them up here while we're chopping this up, but that and I forgot one of the songs that they sample is Isley Brothers, and Tommy Z's wearing his shirt, Isley Brothers Fight the Power. So they're taking a song from, I think, 74, 75 called Fight the Power, that in that time is talking about government inability to function and how people got to cut the red tape and we got to fight the power to make life right in our communities. So they openly, Chuck's like, yeah, I'm refreshing something that was done a previous generation. That's what I'm doing. I'm refreshing this and then connecting it to this long chain of struggles that goes back to when we first got here in 1619. You know, we wasn't no immigrants. You know, or as Malcolm would say, we didn't land on Plymouth Rock. Plymouth Rock landed on us. All right. And so they want to express that. And I think a very, very powerful and direct way, a very direct way. I guess the last thing, if I could, real quick, in the time that we're in,
your mic.
Listen to the slaughter of Breonna Taylor and George Floyd. I mean, Breonna, that killing just it to me, I can't. Every time I think about it, you know, I start to choke up because that was. Absolutely crazy. And none of them have been brought to justice. One dude has been fired, but ain't nobody been arrested for that. So going back to little babies, you know, they just come to kill us. They don't protect us. But anyway, one of the things I do want to mention is in the, I think it's the third verse toward the end of the song, where Chuck is talking about most of our heroes don't appear in those stamps. And I think it's particularly relevant in this time where you're having people challenge these Confederate statues and all of these other statues, where, you know, it's to me, it's kind of odd. I don't think it's controversial at all, particularly around the American Civil War, because you know what West Point did right after the American Civil War, and all these generals that turned and became Confederates, they took all their pictures off the wall because they were traitors. This is not controversial. It's not, it's not something that's, you know, really an issue. And instead of society asking us, well, where does it stop? And where do you know? Where do you draw the line? It's like, well, no, the question is, how come all of our memorials celebrate murderers, rapists, slavers? That should be the question. Mm-hmm. So Public Enemy is raising that. It's like, okay, John Wayne, we're supposed to believe he's a hero. And he's like, yeah, black people ain't ready to be civilized for another 50 years.
Be frozen. That's a weird space to be frozen.
I don't know if he's frozen.
He might be that shocked. But there he is.
And
perfect.
One of the things that Baldwin said was that in addition to the what he called the catastrophe, the chronic, the tolls. I forget the phrase he uses, a beautiful term of phrase that he talked about, daily encounters with the police or landlords or banks, insurance companies, businesses that will hire you. He's like, there's this greater problem that he wouldn't use the term white supremacy, but that's what he was talking about. And it's how it shapes reality. It shapes our very reality that we can't even create the community that, you know, Dr. Tommy C was talking about, because our reality is such that no, certain people aren't even worth being in the community. They're not even supposed to be here. They don't deserve a judge, jury, and executioner. They don't deserve the presumption of innocence, which is a core principle of our legal system. They don't even deserve that. So when you have that kind of shaping of reality, Public Enemy's fighting back against that with Fight the Power and pushing that and saying, no, there's this reality that you know is has nothing to do with actual life in America. This is what actual life in America is about. All right, and I'll stop there.
No, no problem. Thank you for touching on that. And we always get, at least every time I turn on CNN or MSNBC, there's always this talk about having the discussion on racial indifferences and justice, changing the system. It's always a discussion. But I wanted to shift that same song to Professor Z. I'll ask, they touched on Elvis, John Wayne, and the 400 years of slavery.
Yeah.
As someone who studied culture and music and the significance, not just the quantitative, but the qualitative mm-hmm. impact of music, what can you say has been that significance that they're talking about for those cultures, but, I guess as far as the protests go and music coming out now, you know, what do you think will be the difference maker outside of the discussion?
Well, you know, talk is cheap, right? It's all about action. It's all about what we do, right? It's about all about the bat hitting the ball and hitting the ball leaving the park, right? So, you know, it's all about the grand slam. And do we have the strength and the wisdom to do that? And I keep coming back, I hold it in the forefront of my mind and in my heart, the Audre Lorde quote, you know, there is no liberation without community. And I know I referenced this earlier, but I'll say it again, the COVID thing is really holding us back because we can't gather in the streets. And I don't know how many of you saw the Dave Chappelle special. If you haven't, listeners, please, please take the time to seek it out.
Yep. And it's 8:32.
Yeah. You know, it's not even 9 minutes, and talk about science being dropped. He did it real quick. And he also did it right away. And you can see the people doing the social distancing out in the open. It's an amazing bit of film, but he said, you know, people were calling him out. Why haven't you said anything? And then he came out and said something. And basically what he said was, I trust the streets. And back to the sort of line I keep drawing about 2020, always, you know, back to 2000 and reference Dr. White's, you know, 1619, you know, this, and even before we could go back 2000 years about oppression and slavery, and the way we treat each other is what this is all about, right? And the way the doors we open for each other and what the access and knowing what we're seeing, understanding what's in front of us. I was in Whole Foods recently, and En Vogue's Free Your Mind came on just, you know, it was background music. It was so weird for that to be background music in 2020. And so I spent some time of it. And, you know, you could, when they say, you know, you got to know how to read me, you have to know what you're seeing and understanding what's there. And these monoliths that we're using very quickly in this day and age of Instagram and Twitter and some of these things, we just keep flashing them at the optic nerve. But to get back to your question about Elvis, John Wayne, you know, Elvis did mean something to me. And I think Chuck D is a very, very, very smart man. And he pokes us right in the eyeball with that, right? We jolt. And what did Elvis do? Well, he was from, you know, he was from down south, and he heard all this great music and he shared it with people. And did he give folks credit? We can talk about that. There's this other little band you may have heard of called the Beatles, who did a very similar thing that took the music of Little Richard and Chuck Berry and shared it with the world. So back to sharing, you know, they got it into people's ears and people's hearts and they took those rhythms. But I'm not trying to fault Elvis. I'm not trying to fault the Beatles. I'm trying to talk to what you were asking about, the whole process of music and the sharing and using technology well, whether it's a 45 or the internet and stuff in between. We can talk about the appropriation of music, but also Little Richard talked about, you know, Pat Boone covered my song and people got to hear me and they sought me out. They went to find the truth. And that's what we got to be. We got to be truth seekers. We got to know when it's just facade and go beyond. And also we got to know what an Elvis represents, what a John Wayne represents, what are these manifestations? You could use the term mask, I guess, but everything means something. I'm not going to say you can ignore this. You know, we live in the middle of cancel culture right now, right? 2020 was canceled. and so I think we need to slow everything down as we have with in times of COVID, and really see what's in front of us in order to read it. And then when we share it as a community and say, check this out, this is what I hear, and this is what I love, what do you hear? And we can chew on it slowly and share it as a cipher, right? Then we can really get deep into it. So I'm trying to put into a soundbite what I think about Elvis and John Wayne and all these folks, you know, taking this culture and redefining masculinity and femininity and race and all these identities, that actually is something we're still doing today in 2020. What does it mean when hip hop has become mainstream? And we see this with rock and roll. We see this with blues. When things start out small, they're really cool. I mean, bebop was a great example of this. It was in the clubs late at night. It was really cool. And then it goes overground. And what does it mean? Is it the same thing? Same thing with rock and roll, when was it just in San Francisco or just in Greenwich Village, and then Woodstock, and then everyone had it. Is it the same thing when it's not a thing that is closer to you and that then can begin to define a smaller community in a way that a mainstream major community, there's something lost when the size is expanded. There's a nuance in the thing. I'm not trying to be romantic in any way. But when things go overground, what Wes was talking about, when things explode, they turn into something else. When you split an atom, bad things happen. But then the power is in the small. I hope that's amazing.
amazingly complete answer. I was as you were sharing that, I was thinking about the term culture vulturing and how every bit of music shares something in common, whether it's the melody, the bass line. And when it comes to what I've learned about copywriting and how much of that is shareable, how much you can't take a core progression, just the fact that, you know, in our society, that kind of translates.
Well, if I may say, there are only 12 notes, right? It's what you do with them, right? Mm-hmm. Thank goodness the 12 notes of the major scale are not copyrighted. And the same thing with a blues progression, you know, 12 bars or similar things. They're you know, it's what we end up mixing, right? Yep. Together,
your term of sharing.
Yes. Yes, sharing the small to create something larger. And then it's what we do with it. It's hipping up a rhythm. know, that's Louis Armstrong, right? Taking a straight song and turning it into something else just because he sang it. He put that Louis Armstrongness on top of it. Thank God, you know?
Yeah, if I can just sort of add on to this, and I think the, I'm gonna have a somewhat more, I guess, cataclysmic view of John Wayne and the Beatles and everybody to Dr. Tom. And now I think you're making a good point. I think there is something to say what Little Richard said about Pat Boone, right? There's a sense of like, yes, there's a commerce you want to play to the wider audience. But I think there's think about the Stones or the Beatles. They were very clear about where, or Eric Clapton. They drew the line themselves. I think that there's people like Elvis who sort of smudged it a little bit and was like, well, you got to figure it out. But if you don't figure out, I'm happy to take all the credit. And there's some people who are like, don't give me all the credit. And I almost think about hip hop, and I may be a bit of a romantic, but it's been so much harder to steal the essence of hip hop, you know, when you go over the top, as Dr. Tom says. And I don't know what that is. I like to think that it's something special, but I think back to what Dr. White was saying about it's the head on attack, right? You know what I mean? Like MF him and John Wayne, you know, my heroes and princes, there's no debate of like, I don't like this, I don't like that cop, I don't like this, boom, boom, boom. And then when it gets to the mainstream and you say, well, I want to sort of massage those samples of those 12 notes, you get this sort of mealy mouth, like G-Eazy, Macklemore, you know, like you can't, it's not the same once you put it through. And I think there's something about that I love about the power of hip hop is that it's so revolutionary. It cannot be, I mean, it's obviously, you know, Puff went and made a big mainstream and you see it all over the place now and Pepsi ads and all sorts of stuff, but it's still not been as sanitized as I think before. And I do think we need to call out, you know, we need to be make it clear. Maybe, you know, Dr. Tom better than me. He's like, you know, be clear what that Led Zeppelin riff came from. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Let's put it out there as educators, as professionals.
Yes.
What the Beatles were playing in Liverpool before, you know, what the Who was trying to do before, and that it was these really broke black people, you know, playing the blues in Memphis and all that. Let's make sure they get some publishing credits. They need to get a piece of that streaming economy because, you know, I think a lot of times, like there is, you know, you listen to Led Zeppelin and it is what some people call Eminem, right? Eminem, you know, took battle rap and people are like, oh, now I get it. Mm-hmm. You know, and Eminem, I don't think is a vulture, but I think he ran with a lot of vultures who allowed the vulturing to happen, you know what I mean? And I think we got to call it out a little bit and make sure that we retain that line.
Thank you for making that distinction between the two.
Wes just said something that just, I was like, I promise to this as well, is that, again, when hip-hop at its inception at that party in 73, up until, say, right before Sugar Hill Gang dropped, all this art is being created by kids for other kids. That's it. And they're talking to themselves. Public Enemy emerges at a time as a group where hip hop is still kind of subculture. And what Public Enemy does is say, America's always gazing on us, at us, and gazing at us and saying, well, this is who you people are. We're returning the gaze. So whether you agree or not, it is a clear and direct confrontation to say, I'm returning the gaze. This is what I see. All right, this is what I see. And I think that is truly really significant because again, even their predecessors, you know, Grandmaster Flash, Furious Five, The Message, talked about the state of the South Bronx, but they didn't really return the gaze. They just kind of confirming, yeah, all these things you heard about the South Bronx, yeah, it's real. Whereas Public Enemy's like, no, I'm looking at you. You know, I'm looking at American history, and this is what it is.
As a historian, how do you feel about reparations for black musicians? Do you think that's a possibility?
Well, you asked two questions. So how do I feel about it? I love it. Is it a possibility? Probably not. But, you know, I definitely love it. I mean, I think that if you're going to create justice, then part of it has to be through a process of repairing, not just having a conversation, but repairing. And so I think that, yeah, reparations are a great idea. How that would unfold, I don't know the specifics, but I think it's a great idea. And will it actually happen? It'll have to be forced. It'll have to be compelled, just like Wes was saying about the Washington NFL team. You know, people been, cats I know that are Native American activists been protesting this for years and can't get Dan Snyder to budge. And FedEx, boom, that was it. Oh yeah, game over. Let's meet. Let's have a meeting and talk about this, you know? And so, yeah, I think it's going to have to be compelled, but I love the idea. Absolutely love it.
Yeah, and they threw in lift every voice and sing to boot.
Yeah, they can live this. But let Jay and Beyonce go to Live Nation and say, I'm not going back on the road again until you pass this law that has reparations back to those blue czars. Watch how fast it changes. And then let Cole get a part of that, and then let a Maroon 5, let the allies get in on that and watch it change. If anything is I've learned, and I have to say this, and this may not be the appropriate thing to say, but I've been having these conversations with Ebony of being at York College, right? Public institution, which is predominantly people of color, and then going up at Emerson, which is a private college, predominantly white. It's a difference in the way people move, right? When people at Emerson are besmirched, or whether it be faculty or students, that clapping is coming immediately, right? Sometimes when it's black folks, it's like, well, you know, maybe and you start negotiating against yourself, which I've been saying to my kids over and over again. We need to stop saying, I think that the analysis that Dr. White has is good for this call, but to the public, going to be like, this is what I want. I want reparations. Tell me why I can't. And it's almost like that. We were talking this morning, like that Karen energy, right? That people push against. I'm like, I think we need a little bit more of that, of saying like, yo, what are you doing? You know what I mean? What is this? Where is my money, right? Where's my reparations? Where is my equality? My grandfather's muddy waters, and he doesn't have health insurance. Give it to me. And then let's negotiate from that. Tell me why. Tell me why I can't get it. You know, instead of right back to the statues, to Dr. White saying, it's an absurd argument. You know what I mean? It's an absurd, why are my enslavers got statues? Where's yours? Let me go to Munich. Where's the Goebbels statue? Because we got to keep it real, right? You know, where's the King George statue? You know, in New York, it's only us that always get this bad deal. And I'm saying we need to go back to the table and say, check this out. This is what's going to happen. Cut the check, or there's no, or these core clutch sports artists are not going to play in the NBA. So that means Anthony Davis, LeBron, you know, Trae Young, we leaving until we come back. And then let again, Cole and Chance and Lil Baby and all of that, and watch how quickly things change. So I think we need to make more statements and less questions, and make you tell me why there shouldn't be reparations. Because we have the truth on our side. Our ancestors were robbed. So by you, and I can figure out it was you, Capitol Music, you know what I mean, who took it, who didn't pay the royalties. We can come right for it. So I just want to be, I think it's time for what hip hop can do. I know I'm mixing things. I'm sorry to get you off course, Jeremiah, but we need to use this, you know, what's happening with the COVID, where we can connect like this with the Black Lives Matter protests, get more organized, and approach all these systems with lists of demands that are contingent upon our full return to the economy.
That's brilliant. I keep hearing that there's two factors that factored into George Floyd's death that made it such a national awareness, worldwide awareness that is the fact that it happened in broad daylight and was filmed for almost 9 minutes, and the fact that we have COVID ongoing. And a lot of people are at home, don't have, you know, more to do than binge, and, you know, they can afford, you know, while the economy's down, to go out and make a difference. There's more awareness that way. we talked about moving forward, but I wanted to bring up to you, Professor Jackson, as far as the vulturing and gentrification and protecting our artistic integrity, our intellectual property, as far as historically. How do you think the next Brooklyn Hip Hop Festival is going to start? Where should it be? And how do we make that, you know, more of a movement in preserving that heritage, that legacy?
Yeah, and I think that's a wonderful thought and a question, is that, and something I've been spending a lot of time thinking about, is it's more of this. We quite simply need to connect people like Dr. Tom and Dr. White, as well as Quash and Ebony, more to the people. It's that simple. We have 20, right? Maybe 20, when I was getting out of college, maybe this was fine to take a couple of lumps. But now we got PhDs, tenured professors who are part of the culture. They're Black, they're white, they're ethnomusicologists, they're chairs. Like, we have another level. There's more soldiers or generals now in the game. So now we can scoop. I want to provide, to be honest with you, Jeremiah, I'm no longer interested in the concert, right? I know people love the concert. I love the concert. Ebony hates it because that's when she had to do all of her hard work. But it's hard, right? It's expensive. Now we're going up against AEG and Live Nation. It's very hard. And we were a small Black-owned, female-owned family business. It's difficult. We are, those artists that we supported, they have ways to get their music out there, thank goodness. But what we don't have enough is this conversation of saying, you know, there's an affiliated, what you guys call adjunct, that I just hired up at Emerson, this sister named Bomathy, who's a lawyer. And she's basically an intellectual property lawyer, a woman who's about, a woman of color, who is about ending the theft of intellectual property by women and people of color. She's like, that's what my practice is about, is returning those rights. So I need to get Bomathy in front of those artists that used to play the festival and say, put this into your contract, right? Put this carve out into your, we had a lecture yesterday that you prevent Trump from using your song, you know, at a rally, you know, but no,
thanks for bringing that up, negotiating power.
Yes. Right. And we just don't know. You get that blanket. You don't realize is when you publish a work of art and you register with ASCAP, then, you know, the Barclays does a deal with ASCAP that gives access to their entire catalog. So if Barclays says, if Trump comes to Barclays and says, I want to play Fight the Power because I'm fighting the power against the swamp, Chuck and Flav and Eric Vietnam Salad have no say, because you gave that right away. But we can negotiate the new deal for Lil Baby and say, Lil Baby, put this carve out in your publishing agreement that there's that I get to approve political use, because I do not want fascists. I am for Black liberation. And to what Dr. White said, I do not want fascists. I am an anti-racist. I do not want white supremacists have the ability to use my song. So what I want to dedicate myself to, and again, 15 years ago, it was cool to do shows with Q-Tip and, you know, and De La Soul and all my idols. I love that. And I love those brothers to death and what they did. But now I've got 3 kids. You know, I see the world differently. People are being choked out on the streets. Do we need another party? I don't know, man. I think we need to galvanize this vote and make sure that, you know, Tish James becomes the next governor of New York State, so nobody starts messing with the CUNY budget no more. Right. And we need to get Hakeem Jeffries, the next Speaker of the House, you know what I'm saying, my congressman. And then, you know, that's what we can do now. And now we have people that can articulate, because I run my mouth and I'd be like, Dr. White, that make any sense? And then he could correct me and get me right. And then we can go do the fundraiser, you know, and then Dr. Tom. So what those reparations, let's talk about it from an ethnomusicologist sense. How can we do that? Boom. So now the 3 of us need to go up to Congress and say, this is what I want to get. That's what I want to do with the Brooklyn Hip Hop Festival, is be more dedicated to anti-racist liberation, right? That's my new thing. And I hope that, you know, everybody with me. Listen, you better stop clocking, Dr. White. I'm going to call you after this. And you're going to be on a train to Boston, brother. You too, Dr. Tom. But yeah, and what you and Brian are doing, Jeremiah, we need this. We need you doing what you do, and add you to the mix.
Yes, you do. throw a brother a bone. Need some interns or plug myself on. Hey, so I wanna move it over to our co-host. You have a little history of the music with the law. So as far as passing the torch goes, what do you say to the young brother who, you know, all he knows is voting in November? What do you say to the artist who doesn't know much about, you know, intellectual property or any of that, but he has hella passion? So what are the right mediums? Who are the right people for them to go to? What should they do next?
Yeah, I would definitely say, you know, when I, let me put a caveat on this. When I practiced law, I was not an entertainment lawyer, but I could read a contract. I could read. So I would send them to Wes and say, yo, you need to talk to this dude before you sign anything. All right. But I think that so much of, you know, what I would say to young artists is to be themselves and to wrap up about create the art that they create. I don't like the idea of forcing people to be role models. I would rather them just be. And so that if it turns out that, yeah, Cardi B is like the Democratic Socialist of America spokesperson unintentionally, that's fantastic. I think that's great. So I would encourage artists to be themselves, but to really think about, really, again, think about what they're doing as creating art. Because if you think, oh, I'm just going to make a hit and I'm just going to get famous and I'm going to get this big fat advance, you're in for trouble. And I talk in the class about the difference between trying to make a hit and making art. And if you take it as making art, then you're going to take it seriously and then try to protect yourself. And so that's what I would say to young folks coming up.
No, that's major. Doing it for the clout or doing it for your career, doing it for your artistry, whether you have it to get paid, what you're building experience-wise. So I guess I'll pose the same question to Professor Jackson or Professor Z if you want to hop in. To the musicians, let's go with Professor Z first, who, you know, have that classical training but want to merge over to hip-hop or understand jazz and don't really feel that it has a place anymore. To those who say it's like if music's a universal language, it's a dead language now. What do you say to those as far as revitalizing those musics? And I kind of remembered your book, Free from Jazz, on this point.
Yeah, my dissertation was called Free from Jazz. I looked at Austrians and how they played music in Austria and here in New York. And they tried to get away from this thing called jazz. And I think that's some really good advice, what Dr. White is saying about being yourself. If we look at everyone who made impact, right, to reference Steve Jobs, made a dent in the universe, they were individuals, right? They were people, anybody, Louis Armstrong, to name jazz, you know, all the way through Jimi Hendrix, you just drop something that you love there, and they're an iconoclast, right? They pierced the veil and went on through, and bam. And so, yeah, it's not about making a quick hit. There are one-hit wonders, but those songs that we listen to that is by one person one time have something in that. There's an atom in that molecule we want to chew on, right? That we want to enjoy. And I have to push back on this idea of music as a universal language. I say to all my students, I will go back and change your grade. If you say, if I find out that you said music is a universal language, you are wrong, because it is a lie. There are a lot of people who want you to know this, but you play a song in front of 50 people, they will think and feel at least 50 different things. If not, I mean, there's a multiplicity to music, just like a diamond. There are all these different ways in. And so it's this flattening that I would like to push back against, and what Wes said about things, you know, getting shaven down or smoothed if they go up into the atmosphere or get bigger. I think of free jazz. I know not a lot of people do, but I do. And free jazz was a project to play something that could not be imitated. You know, swing was imitated. And if you are free, it's all about who you are and what you have to bring to the team. You only have you and the people with you. And hip hop knows this really well with different flows and different crews and all this kind of stuff. So no, music is not a universal language. Thank God. We have all these different ways of communicating one another, and not all messages are for all people, and not all messages are embedded in stone for all time, right? You know, messages, Dr. King's words now are some, you know, there's a brilliance to it that just rings through in a way, and we can go back to anybody thousands of years, that their words glimmer in a different way. So what would I say? I say, do you, right? And get a good crew with you, make sure that they're strong, make sure you got a good band, make sure you got a good lawyer, make sure you got a good publicist, a killer graphic artist. I mean, hip hop had that right? They had the MC, the DJ, and the B-boys, right? And the graffiti. It was a full package. And rock and roll had that right. And you know, all the things that worked, whether it's music or computers or vacuum cleaners, you know, it's a whole package. And that's when it really gains speed and goes forward. And we got to have room for the nuance and the wiggle and all these other things that make these things unique. And some things are only for a moment. Some things are for all time. Some things are just for a decade. And so I think we need to have that space to see things in a different light, and that they have different usabilities over time. So I think we need to be us.
If I can just
say great.
Real quick to that, what Dr. Tom said, I think that's quite, music as a universal language is almost the version of like, I don't see color, you know?
Yes, yes.
It's like this low key insult. I never thought about it like that. Like, what you mean? You know, but you know, this is my heritage, right? It's not the same as if you've never heard it. So I think it's great. But I think the other thing is also, you know, I just echo what all the brothers are saying here is, when you realize that you're composing intellectual, you're creating intellectual property, right? Which we can call art or music or whatever it is. And you treat that treat it like your house, right? It's property that you own, that you can monetize, that you can borrow against. It will change your perception. But to the point about, you know, the do you, almost to the one hit wonder, sorry, is I've also said to my students, like, listen, it's okay. There's McDonald's and then there's steakhouses. They both serve beef. They have fundamentally different functions. You can't go to McDonald's and eat a hamburger and be like, I don't eat beef because of that experience. That's not very bright. And then you can say, listen, you go to Peter Luger's, you better bucket, you know, that's like an hour and a half experience. McDonald's is, it should be 3 minutes. So, you know, I'm trying to think of like Amigos. Like I used to push back against Amigos for a long time until I was like, you know what? That's fine for what they're doing. You know, those brothers are good. You know, stop judging them by this sort of snobbery thing. It's cool. But I bet you if Quali, I keep going back to him, tried to make like a Versace song or whatever that is song, it would be horrible. So everybody has their part. And when I need this, I go here. When I go there, we're like mature individuals, right? Who do say, I don't see color or this other stuff. Like, no, I see it. I'm black, you white, you Jewish. Yeah, what's good? Let's go to the next conversation. I also say that as well. So I think it opens up some room. Some people are like, listen, man, I had a rough day. I just want to party. I just want to make a song about escapism. You know, my Cadillac car and all of this stuff. Like, leave me alone. Like, all right, that has a place. And there's some people like Chuck is like, I gotta drop. I gotta give you a little bit of. I gotta teach you about Joanne Chesimard. You know, so there's a place for. But no, so Quash got a question. I'll shut up. Sorry.
All right. We have a questioner from a listener. Is there any merit to the argument that campuses have become ideological echo chambers? We'll send this to Dr. White. And thank you, gents, for your comments.
The short answer is absolutely not. The long answer is that a lot of people that say this do not like what takes place on college campuses, whether it's seeking of truth, because there are a lot of people that don't want truth right now. There are spaces on college campuses where we affirm oppressed people. We affirm women. We affirm LGBTQ community. They don't like that either. But the other thing that really is disturbing in the question, and I'm not saying that the questioner themselves is disturbed, but this is something that people repeat, and it's fair to ask, you might as well ask, is that people assume as if we have some kind of hive mind in the college, and that in some beautiful time in the past, we didn't. And I don't want to get into a long disquisition about higher education, but just let me put it this way. There's a reason why we have so little Black history in our curriculum. And it's not because there's some ideological echo chamber in America's colleges and universities now. It was because there was one prior to the 1950s and 60s. And so breaking down those doors broke up that echo chamber. But now, no, there's disparate views on a lot of different things. And just the fact of being able to say, like Professor Jackson just said, I'm about anti-Black survivalism. That is a threat. And when other people repeat that, like me, like Tommy Z, like other people repeat that, there are constituencies, large constituencies in this country that are upset by that. And they believe, oh, well, they're all the same. And it's like the Borg and Star Trek Enterprise. And they're, oh, my God. You know, it's like, no, dude. We're just trying to affirm life. That's what we believe in. We're trying to do that. So, you know, now there's no ideological echo chamber. And I think what you'll find is as many different views on as many different things, just like Dr. Tommy Z said, just about politics, let alone about history or music or any other form of art. So, no.
All right, well, we're just about wrapping up. We'll take some time and give these gents, our guests, their time for final thoughts. We'll give you a few minutes. We can start with our first guest.
Is that me?
Professor Jack, that's you.
Okay. I don't know the order. I put myself at the back of the list when I got smart people like this around. But I think my final thought, maybe to build on what Dr. White was saying, yeah, that argument, not to disparage the writer, it's a setup, right? That's a setup. It's I spend way too much energy arguing with white people I went to prep school with, you know, about this issue. Until one time I was having a debate about why you shouldn't, I got pulled into the mud talking about why you can't make comments and posts implying that you're going to lynch somebody, right? I'll leave it at that. Which turned into a whole thing, which the final thought was, Wes, you don't like white people. And I'm like, wait, you know, like you got to do the Scooby-Doo. Like, how'd that happen? And I said, this whole conversation was a setup. I'm talking to you as if you're a reasonable person that's going to listen, can debate and argue vociferously, pleasantly, but really, you know, say, you know, you're the person, I think that people just don't want to say Black Lives Matter because they don't think Black Lives Matter, right? There are people, there are white supremacists that have couched it in conservatism, in blue lives, the blue wall. There's a lot of people have couched all of this stuff in this different language. So I say to that caller, I've been blocked by friends or people I thought were friends. And I said, after that exchange, I said, this is good. Because after the Black Lives Matter, the George Floyd protest, I don't want to waste my time with you. I only want to talk to people who are going to organize and push the ball forward. Now, I have people, you know, I got a white brother that I've been coaching lacrosse with for almost 10 years. He's a hardcore Bernie person. I'm a little bit more of like the Hillary Biden, like we got to compromise. We don't agree. You know what I mean? But he is for anti-racism and the humanity of all people. And he is against violence against women. So this little thing about, are you a social democrat and I'm a capital D? We could debate that. But if you're saying like, leave me alone, I want to write posts about lynching Black people, you know what? Don't come. And what you don't want to say is what's happening is in these spaces, what's happening is you got Dr. Tom and Dr. White talking, and they're like, oh no, that's a a white guy and a black guy talking, so I can no longer say it's just a black thing. Because Dr. Tom, like, no. Yep, my dissertation says same thing as Dr. White's, moving on. And the racists hate that. So that's why we're in this space building with one another. And they want to almost, delegitimize our space. But yeah, there are debates happening in there. You know, at Emerson, what I deal with more than ever at York is, we have a lot of trans students, right? So people were putting in evals, like, I got dead named. And people were like, what does that mean? You know, I'm too old, I don't understand. Like, oh my God, that's what that means? You know, I was calling you Joseph when you want to be called Mary. Yo, check me, knock me down, and we want to move forward. So that's where we're having these elevated conversations, and they want to pull us back to, Dr. White says, to this insane conversation. So I know our time is running short, and I will shut up, but I think we need more of this to keep building. That's my final thought.
Not to cut you off, but before we run out of time, I want to give Dr. Kwasi the opportunity to introduce our other guest.
Yes, really quick, and I know Dr. White, Dr. Zlabinger are going to give their closing remarks in a second, but we are delighted to have the leader of our Division of Enrollment Management and Student Affairs on the line with us. He's the one and only Dr. Latoro Yates. He's not the one from MySpace, but he's the one who's here with us today. Dr. Latoro Yates, if you would just greet the audience.
Yes. So thank you. I caught the last bit of what you said, Mr. Jackson. I think it's the truth. It's not a one-on-one thing. It's a we thing. It's a us thing. So the more we start to get together, move in that direction, and the more we refuse to allow people to separate us. The bottom line is accepting someone's truth and being able to deal with that person's truth. And what happens is sometimes some folk are quick to disqualify something that someone is saying. And that's the part where the issue rises. I can look a racist in the face and listen to what they have to say and then be able to say, I totally disagree with that, because I know people and I've dealt with people. I played college football. I played organized sports since I was 8 years old through the 26 and just been a fan and just sat in the stands and just talked. And if you really want to see how people come together, you can go to Tuscaloosa, Alabama and see a racist outside cooking on their grill. And then when that ball kick off and that running back take that ball into a touchdown, we all hugging and kissing then. So if we can hug and kiss over football, why can't we do it in society? So I refuse to believe that we can't come together. What we have to do is just not fall for the smoke screen. And I'm going to be quiet there, but what I do want to say is that I truly appreciate the team at York, everyone that put this together, having this young brother, this young student is taking the lead, everyone moving forward. And it's important to give the voices. What you will hear from me and my tenure, no longer how much longer it is that I believe in handing the baton to the next generation and being able to move from a manager to a coach to a consultant. So Dr. White and Dr. T and all of us, we're now consultants for that new generation. So we just want to be there and help in any way we can. So again, I want to say salute. And I also look forward to, this is just the start. And the more we get this platform growing and moving, we'll get more people to come and be a part of the discussion. And the important part is the discussion. And we recorded the discussion so we could push it out as much as possible. So today was a major success. And thank you again, Mr. Jackson and all of the team. The team is what's important. And they know I always say that. And Jonathan always got to get that MySpace thing there. So I'm going to leave it alone. That's another discussion. Dr. White for president. I'm still going with that.
Thank you.
Yes. All right, I'm sorry, Gary.
And Professor Z, DJ Z, we have a few minutes for you, and then I'd like to close up.
Sure. I've got, my brain is just exploding with ideas, and I want to thank everyone who's in this call today for their honesty and their wisdom. And it comes back to how we treat each other. It really does. And my work, what I'm working on now, is connecting blues to psychedelic music. Wes referenced Led Zeppelin. We got to plug it back into Willie Dixon, right? We got to find how these things connect. And it's amazing how much of our culture comes from the Mississippi Delta. And not enough people are talking about it. In the Delta, this is where we lost track of who was who and what was what and up was down. And we have, there's
I'm not going to go into it here, but what I'm finding in my work is that there's a reason that people on both sides of the Atlantic drew inspiration from this music, not only in the lyrics, but how it was constructed, the fact that they used guitars and electric guitars and then processed it, and the sonic barriers that someone like Jimi Hendrix knocks down. I can't imagine hip hop without Hendrix. And I can't imagine so many things without Hendrix because of what he did, not only musically, what he represented, but what he did technologically, rewiring his own pedals and things like that. And then his stage show, right? And asking heavy, heavy questions. So I want to thank everyone for having this deep conversation where we got into this groove of a deeper music. And yes, we just got to do it again and keep taking it back, plugging it back in.
Thank you. Thank you, gents. And thank you for taking the time and the energy and sharing. We, as a younger generation, get the shortcut of listening to you guys. While we have another minute, I wanted to just take a moment of silence for all those who have sacrificed their lives for the protests, those who have passed the police brutality, and those who passed away even at our university due to COVID. So we'll take a few seconds for that. All right. And I want to
thank you, Jeremiah, for doing such a great job. If we all give you a great, great hand, all the listeners on YC Radio Plus on Facebook and on YouTube, thank you very, very much for tuning in today. We've had an amazing show. Our leader, Dr. Yates, is here with us. He's pushing us to do these wonderful shows. And Ebony Jackson has taken the baton to create the Social Justice Institute. And we're going to keep the fire going in August. I'm hoping we're going to put together, you know, I know Tom will love this. We're going to put together a show on social justice and jazz, because I'd love to see, I'd love to talk about that myself. But I think I want to thank all the guests, as well as Dr. Tony Andrews, the coordinator for the YC radio program, who's with us in another form, but he's listening to the show and texting me every like 6 seconds, but I do appreciate that. And to thank all the guests again. Mostly Brian Graves, thank you so much for producing today's show and doing a great, great job. Again, listen to YC Radio. Make sure you tune in for future events, and see you then.
World. It's bigger than all these fake records.